Hi everyone, Aaron here for Zolotech, and today Apple finally released iOS 16.4 Developer Beta 1. This is available to all developers around the world at the same time. iOS 16.4 Public Beta 1 should be out usually within a day or so. Now, this particular update is a very large install if you're on the public version of iOS 16.3 or iOS 16.3.1. You'll see it came in at 5.44 gigabytes. That's on my iPhone 14 Pro Max. So anytime you go from a regular version to a beta or from a beta back to a regular version, you're going to reinstall the whole OS. It'll be a huge install, and then it will just overwrite the old OS. Now, this was released alongside iPadOS 16.4 Beta 1, WatchOS 9.4 Beta 1, macOS 13.4 Beta 1, and tvOS and HomePodOS 16.4 Beta 1. Now, let's go ahead and talk about what's new, as well as the build number. There is a lot to talk about in this, such as new emoji and much, much more. Now, let's go to Settings. We'll go to General, then About. As you can see, the build number is 20E5212F, and this particular update does have a modem update. If you're updating from the previous versions, you should have some sort of modem update to help with overall connectivity and more. Now, the new features in this, the first thing has to do with updating software in general. Apple is changing this with the next version, with Beta 2. If we go to the software update page, you'll see there's now beta updates. Under beta updates, if you're a public beta tester or a developer, you'll get these options. They're now going to be tied to your beta developer account with your Apple ID. So there's no longer going to be a profile. You'll need to sign up with your Apple ID, and then you'll have these options here. Otherwise, you won't be able to install it. So this is an all new way of doing this. Apple said it's beginning with 16.4 beta, and they said members of the Apple Developer Program will see a new option to enable the betas directly from software updates. So you won't be able to install them with a beta profile any longer, meaning all the websites that sort of feed those beta profiles out to people that aren't developers are going to no longer be relevant, as there's no way to install the beta without actually paying for it, $99 a year. Or if you're a public beta tester, you can sign up for free there. Under the About page, instead of warranty, it now says coverage. If we go into that, it shows all the different coverage for all the devices we have tied to this Apple ID. So you can see coverage expired, or that we have Apple Care Plus or something else. So that's something all new in Beta 1. Under the cellular data options, under voice and data, there's an all new option for 5G standalone. This is something that is new that says it uses 5G for all cellular activity, including cellular network connections. In certain conditions, 5G standalone may be used when necessary to provide cellular service. This hints at upcoming 3 gigabit per second service around the world and in different areas. So that's something that's all new. And also, some people have informed me that iOS 16.4 Beta 1 brings 5G support for Turkey as well. So if you're in Turkey and you're seeing that, let us know in the comments below. If we go into messages, there's all new emoji to comply with Unicode 15 standards. You can see them here. We have a shaking face. We have a pink heart, a blue heart, a gray heart. We have a donkey, a moose, jellyfish, ginger. We have hands that are facing palm up, toward the right, toward the left, and also within the code, while we don't see it yet, or I haven't been able to find it, there's actually mention of rock, paper, scissors, being able to type rock and seeing a closed fist or your hand open for paper. So maybe that will be a little bit later or something that's coming in the future. Additionally, there's a bunch of different updates for the keyboard, specifically for autocorrect for Korean keyboards. It's enabled by default for testing and feedback if you're in Korea. Also, Ukrainian keyboard now supports predictive text. We also have Gujarati, Punjabi, and Urdu keyboards, which add support for transliteration layouts. And there's new keyboard layouts available for Choctaw and Chickasaw as well. So all of those keyboard updates are in 16.4. There's an all new widget. So if you're using widgets on your widget page here, let's go ahead and add one. We'll add a widget here. If we scroll down, under wallet, there's new widgets for order tracking. So we have three new widgets, and it just shows order tracking in the larger, medium, and small size as well. If you use focus modes like I do, go into your settings, go under focus. And if you have an iPhone 14 Pro or 14 Pro Max with an always on display, if you select a focus and then go to the bottom and add a focus filter, there's some new options, or a new option for always on display. So you can turn that on or off based on your focus overall. So they've finally added that. They've also added a bunch of new shortcut actions. So if you use shortcuts, there's a ton of new actions, and you can see those here. So set silence unknown caller, set stage manager, set true tone, There's also one for set announce notifications, shut down, lock screen, intercom, and set VPN. There could be even more, but so far that's what's been found in shortcuts. Within music and podcasts, we have a bunch of new changes. Apple actually made an announcement about podcasts. We'll get to that in a moment. But if we go into the music app, and we go under our library, under an artist, you can see there's an artist icon at the top now. On the left, I have iOS 16.3.1, iOS 16.4 is on the right. If we go into that artist page itself, we'll just go into the artist page. In the top right, we can favorite the artist. Tap on the star, and at the bottom, it now says favorited. On the old one, it doesn't. It just highlights the star itself. So it's a small change, but something that's updated. Additionally, if we press and hold and maybe play next on one of the songs, there's a new icon or a little graphic that appears below it. So let's do that again. If we press and hold, we'll tap play next. It shows up down at the bottom saying playing next. If we do that on the previous update, it doesn't really show anything other than a large icon in the center. They've changed the overall look to this completely. Also, if we go back to our library, we can now access our profile in the upper right. If we go into albums in the upper right, it now has little arrows for sort instead of the word that says sort. If we go into the podcasts app and we go to our library, there's a new option for channels. So this is all new. So if you're following maybe one of these different channels and they have multiple shows, you can see all of their different shows here. So Vox Media Podcast Network, you'll see them here and see the other shows that they have available. Back under our library page, under our recently updated podcasts, it now gives a count of new podcasts you haven't listened to. So you'll see here it says Gadget Lab, 4 new. On the previous update, it doesn't say anything at all. When you're listening to a podcast and it's complete and it's going to go to the next podcast, it will now give different podcasts that are unplayed, but also that you may not follow, but you might have saved. So it will just progress on to the next podcast that way. These same improvements are going to roll out to CarPlay as well. So if we go into Safari, you can see the announcement here. And within Safari, you can see the announcement where it says iOS 16.4, what's new for Apple Podcasts. So channels that I showed you, up next improvements, enhancements to episode presentation, up next in browse, coming to CarPlay as well. So they're updating it overall, and they'll have even more precise analytics if you actually have a podcast and you want to know about who's listening to it or even watching it. So that's been updated. We should see that with the final release of iOS 16.4. The AirPods icon is changed when it connects to your device. On the right, it's now a gray background with the white AirPods. On the left, previous versions showed white with black. So they've changed that. I'm not sure I like that change. Let me know what you think about it in the comments below. One thing we've known has been coming to iOS for quite some time that they finally implemented with iOS 16.4 is web push notifications. So whether you're on a website or in a website application, it can now push notifications if there's an update. This is something we've had on the Mac for a long time that they're finally bringing to iOS. Within the Home app, Apple has brought the Home architecture update back with iOS 16.4. We had it in the past. Apple removed it or pulled it from devices due to problems. Now it's returned. So that's returned in 16.4 along with manual and automatic software update support on Matter accessories. So if you're using Matter accessories, you can now switch between automatic and manual. I need to get a Matter accessory though so I can see that. If you're using Passkey, there's something that can be enabled by developers, and that's autofill. So Passkey autofill on websites can be implemented with 16.4. And on the iPad side, there's support for tilt and azimuth support for apps. So that's something that developers can implement with Apple Pencil. Also, Swift, or Swift UI, which is the development app, has a family of new modifiers that let you build even richer, resizable sheet experiences with Swift UI. So those are implemented. That's more for developers, though. Also within the code, there's quite a few things, such as rock, paper, scissors that I mentioned before, Apple Pay savings account support. So that's something that could be coming in the near future. However, Apple could just push that to current devices. And there's also event service apps in here as well. What that is specifically, I haven't been able to find it, but if you have, let me know in the comments below. One bug I'm hearing about that I wanted to make sure you were aware of is NordVPN does not seem to be able to connect to iOS 16.4. So if you're on this version, NordVPN may need an update to work properly. The lag so far hasn't returned, but there's a lot of known issues and bugs that remain in this update. And if we take a look at the feedback app, we can take a look at that. So you'll see in the feedback app, iOS and iPadOS 16.4 notes, and you'll see backup and restore issues. Watch migration might fail when restoring a backup to a new phone. You'll see there's new features, some I mentioned already, as well as deprecations for core telephony and core ML. There's new features for home that I already mentioned, and known issues all throughout. So be careful if you're installing this update, as there's definitely going to be a bunch of known issues for iCloud Drive, as you can see here, as well as fixed issues for MapKit, Pages, Numbers, and Keynote has some known issues. And additionally, there's more known issues just throughout with autofill and more. So still things to be concerned about. And if you're wondering if you should install iOS 16.4 beta 1, well, if you're a developer, I'm sure you already know you're getting into a beta. That's fine if it's not on your main device, but I would probably hold off and just see how this is after a few days, as early betas tend to be a little bit more buggy than later betas. However, so far it seems to be okay, but still, if you're a developer, be sure to try it out. And if you're developing an app for it, but I would wait for the public beta, at least if you want to try it on your main device or maybe a secondary device you have. As far as overall performance so far, ProMotion is nice and fast, and on older devices, whether it's an iPhone 11 or iPhone 8, so far it seems nice and fast. If we go into music, we'll give it a second to load. It's the first time I'm opening it. Seems fairly smooth. And in general, just going into different apps, opening them, whether that's the App Store or something else, seems to be okay. I really haven't noticed anything here as far as issues. So in general, it seems to be behaving as you would expect. But again, it takes a few days to know if we're going to have any slowdowns or anything like that. As far as overall heat of the device, it's been a little bit warm right after installing this huge update, but so far it's nice and cool right now. So no issues there. It seems to be doing fine as far as that goes. We can look into that a little bit more in the weekend follow-ups. As far as battery life, it will take a few days to know, but iOS 16.3.1 battery has actually been quite good for me. It seems to really have improved it for me. I have 99 or 98% battery health now, so that's the first time going in and looking at that. And if we take a look at the last 10 days, yesterday I had 3 hours and 14 minutes of screen active time, 13 hours and 19 minutes of screen idle time. And I used about, well, 60% of my battery or so. So I'm not sure what the screen idle time is, but it wasn't really incredible battery life, but better than I had before. So depending on overall usage, this seems to have improved a little bit, where I can easily get through the day now. I'm not charging before I go to bed at night. I'll put it on the bedstand at night, charge it. But usually I was getting down to 20%. Now I'm at 50% or so by the time I go to bed. As far as future releases, well, usually with early betas, we're on a bi-weekly schedule. So probably not next week, but the week after we'll probably get beta 2. However, Apple could change this. They've been changing a lot of that. However, in between, we could see iOS 16.3.2, as we already have that for tvOS and HomePodOS. So we could see small incremental updates and then probably a final release in March or April with iOS 16.4 to the public. So we could have some sort of event in March. We don't really know, but if we do, usually around that time frame, we'll get a final release. Of course, don't expect any major changes until June with iOS 17. While that's not expected to be a huge update, it is expected to have new features, and usually at WWDC or the Worldwide Developer Conference is when we'll see those. So it's going to be a little while until we see that, but probably not any major features until then. Now, as far as benchmarks, for those of you measuring this, I did run it in Geekbench 5, and there is Geekbench 6 now, so we'll take a look at both. With Geekbench 5, it scored 1,875 for single core, 5,346 for multi-core. If we take a look at the previous times I've run it, so let's find the most current one here, or one of the more recent ones, February 3rd, it was 1,875 and 5,054. So it seems to improve. It's about the same. It's not too much of a big deal. But with Geekbench 6, they've changed it dramatically and the numbers have changed a lot. So if we go into here and we go to CPU benchmark, let's run that and see what we get. Now Geekbench 6 completed and we have 2,515 for single core, 6,066 for multi-core. Now unfortunately this one does not seem to back it up, so I'll take a screenshot of it for next time, but just if you want to compare with your device and see what it's getting, this is what we got with Geekbench 6 the first time I've run it. So that's everything so far in iOS 16.4 Beta 1. Of course, if I find anything else, I'll have more about that in a follow-up later this weekend. If you found anything else I didn't mention, I'd love to hear from you in the comments below. And of course, I'll link this wallpaper in the description as I normally do. If you haven't subscribed already, though, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.